You know, you hear about San Diego and Coronado when you're coming, before you get here, you don't have any idea what you're getting yourself into. And I think one of the magical things about this island is how it's integrated itself into the and military and vice versa.
We're honored to be here and kind of be a part of this event in general. Support Marcus, support the community, get the word out, what these guys have done, what they do.
You know, I spent most of my career here in Coronado, so it's, you know, there's a lot of history and memories here. You know, we train here, we get stationed here. It's a very small, you know, tight-knit community, and a lot of us, this is where we go out, this is where we hang out, where we have all our parties. So I think there's a lot of lineage here with Coronado, with the military history, and, you know, I think they welcome us with open arms, which is something that always is very cool and great to be a part of. You know, when you're here for your whole career, it's great. So that's what I love about, you know, Coronado.
What I think is different about Coronado from other military bases in general is that it's a small town. Coronado still retains its small town feel, yet it has two massive military bases on it. It's the home of the SEAL teams. It's the birthplace of naval aviation. There's aspects of Coronado that should absolutely transcend the fact that it's a small town, yet that small town feel and culture and community still comes up through the two large bases, and I think that kind of helps with keeping us coming back and coming home.
I know sometimes, I think military towns, people aren't used to that, and they come in, it can be a bit overwhelming. You see all the heavy machinery rolling around. I mean, there's jets landing all over the place, the helicopters, then you got us, the Navy SEALs running around all the time and screaming and yelling. But I think it's, over time, what has happened is it's just become a part of the people's lives around here, and so much so that they erected a monument, a statue for the Naked Warrior, which is a huge deal for us. I mean, it's kind of an homage to the frogmen that made us what we are today, and for the community to accept us and to put that up there was a big deal for all of us. So it just kind of solidified the relationship that started so many years ago, and over time has just developed into kind of a family atmosphere.
So we're both producers now. We produce a show on History Channel called The Warfighters, and we really got our start working on Lone Survivor.
Coronado's veterans are very special to us. This year, especially our UDT and Navy SEALs, who are celebrating their 70th year as a presence in Coronado. The Navy SEALs are a special part of the fabric of our community and of our lives. We see them in our bay, in our ocean, we see them running on our beach, we see them running on our sidewalks, strong, sweaty, fierce, like these fearless naval warriors who aren't afraid of anything and mysterious, but we are privileged to know them also close up. We know them as husbands and fathers and neighbors and friends. And we welcome all of you in the SEAL community, especially these four. And happy birthday, Navy SEALs. Today's panel discussion is in anticipation of tonight's special screening of the 2013 film Lone Survivor. It's the story from the memoir written by Marcus Luttrell, who is here with us today from Texas. It's a heartbreaking memoir and a heartbreaking film, and one that we all need to see and take to our hearts.
I'd like to give another round of applause to the Coronado Island Film Festival folks, to Doug and Mary, and to your board of directors. Thank you so much for doing this year after year. Hopefully we'll build and build, and it'll become just like Sundance.
Right.
Christian, if I understood your question, how do Navy SEALs find themselves on mountaintops at 10,000 feet? Well, the acronym SEAL is sea, air, and land. So we're in most parts of most seas, in the air quite a bit. So wherever the fight is, you're going to find Navy SEALs. Today, as you sit here, there are probably SEALs in about 36 different countries right now, providing for our national security.
The only reason we're capable of doing the things that we do is because of how much we care about each other. I mean, the reason we go through that training out there, as well, we want to be Navy SEALs, but you don't understand is what exactly is going on over there. So in the minute we walk through those doors and it starts, they just take everything we ever were away from us. They shred us down to nothing. And the way you, it's kind of funny, the way they, like, you know how you build a Navy SEAL? The same way you temper steel. You get really, really cold and really, really hot. Well, through that training, what happens is that you come to rely on everybody else but yourself. And the best way I try to explain it is the fact when you're getting in there and you're going through those evolutions at the end of the day, in the beginning, you're like, oh, I made it through that. And then he would say, oh, I made it through that. And I'm not sure when it happens. I would imagine after Hell Week sometime, but after an evolution, it goes from saying, I made it through that, to we made it through that. And once that happens, that's when you've crossed over through that curtain or down that rabbit's hole, and we kind of made it for life. So it's that constant reminder of everything that we've been through with each other, whether it's that first day or all the way at the end after 20 years. It's the fearlessness and everything that comes. I don't want to say fearless. I mean, being afraid and having fear are two different things. The one thing that Buzz Training does that no other program does, it teaches us how to harness our fear, all right, because we all have it. And once you're able to do that, then you can do things you didn't think you were capable of. And then if you've got somebody standing next to you that can do the same thing, that's why we can do the things that we do. And it all revolves around that team environment. It's not, and we don't look at it as, I mean, the Admiral down there, he's the Admiral, but he's more to that, more than that to us. I mean, I love that man. He's helped me out my entire career. So the difference between our ranks and everything is one thing to everybody who's looking from the outside in, but if you're on the inside, we're a family. He's the old man. You know, it's that way. I'll always walk that line to honor my Trident because he did. Like, you can't let each other down like that, and it just stays that way constantly.
When people see this movie and they research, you know, Danny Deeds and Axelson and Mike Murphy and their faces are going to come up as well, and that they needed to pay respect to that. And so they did. So they were willing, they did everything I asked. And so, it was not easy, but we had a great team. Mark's a great instructor, and I pulled some guys from Land Warfare to work with me, and we just went at it for 2 weeks.
On that, we actually told them that. We said, if you're not prepared to shoulder that responsibility, because when Axelson's mother Googles his name, his face comes up. But after this film gets released, your face is going to pop up. So if you're not willing to shoulder that responsibility, you need to beefy. Get out of here. Problem was, there were two executive producers in the back of the room that were looking at me when I said that. They looked at me like a corn's going off my head. It was a little rough to get used to. Being under that type of scrutiny in your training, because usually you just tell people, hey, this is what you're going to do, and you're going to do it. Well, it's hard to do when, like, Mark Wahlberg's sitting there looking at you like, yeah, I don't really want to do that. Yeah, but you need to, because if you don't, what's my recourse? Like, what do I do? On that note, though, this one's for you. So Mark came a little late to our training. He had been filming another film. And so we needed to get him up to speed because we were doing live fire maneuvers. We were actually working very hard with these guys, and they were throwing down all the actors all just worked enormously hard to make this film what it was. And so Wahlberg showed up a little bit late. He had just come off another movie, and Ray's like, hey, we gotta get him up to speed. Take him to the other side of the berm. There's another shooting range over there, and I just want you to just work with him, get him up to speed with a rifle so he doesn't hurt anybody.
Yeah, that
makes sense. Because all the other guys were, you know, light years ahead. We had no idea, you know, how Mark could handle himself with a firearm. So brought him over to the side of the barn. I told him exactly what I wanted him to do. I had really, really basic shooting drills. And I look behind me, and Marcus is walking up. Oh my God, I know exactly what's going to happen. So sure enough, Marcus walks up behind us. And I said, all right, Mark, here's what I want you to do. I want you to, so he had a Mark 12. .556 AR-15 based sniper rifle. And he said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to shoulder the weapon, depress the safety, you can fire 2 rounds, safety back on, get off the muzzle, and you're gonna scan left and right, and then we're gonna do it again. I said, okay. So Marcus is standing directly behind him. Now Mark Wahlberg is like 5'8", and Marcus is like 6'3", 6'4". So he's like looking down at him. Wahlberg's trying not to turn around. He's like looking over his shoulder. I'm like, all right, you ready? He's like, yeah, I'm ready. I was like, okay, stand by, bust him. Here's the weapon up. He fires like 7 rounds, drops it, doesn't put the weapon back on safety. I was like, hey, put the safety on. He's like, okay. I was like, how do you feel? He's like, I didn't do it. I was like, I know you didn't do it. We're gonna do it again, okay? He's like, okay. Second time. I'm like, all right, stand by, bust him. Boom, fires like 4 rounds, leaves the safety off. I was like, safety on? He's like, oh yeah, put the safety on. It's like, how do you feel? He goes, I didn't do it. I was like, yeah, I know you didn't do it. And I turned, I was like, Marcus, you gotta leave. And as soon as Marcus left, we got down to business and he figured it out.